Yoshio Tamiya was born in 1905 in the Shizuoka Prefecture. After he grew up and trained as a mechanic, the ambitious young man got involved in starting local transportation services, starting with cars, then trucks, and even a bus line. After a while, even a small rail line. But in 1944, he sold it all to start a factory that was subcontracted to make parts for military aircraft. That same year, he received his military draft card, but was ineligible for military service due to an injured right foot. Ironically, the injury occurring only a few days before the draft card arrived. In 1945, the United States Army Air Force paid a visit to his factory and burned it to the ground. But, as they say, you can't keep a good man down. So, in 1945, after the war was over, he and a partner founded the Tamiya Shoji Lumber Company. They primarily sold construction lumber, which was obviously in high demand in post-war Japan. By 1953, they had given up on the lumber industry and focused on wooden toys and models. And some of them, like this wooden tank, became quite popular. In 1956, Tamiya released a wooden model battleship. 1960 was a busy year for Tamiya. In that year, they started plastic model production with a 1 to 800 scale battleship Yamato. Initially, it did not sell very well, so the wooden battleship was made in parallel with the plastic model. You have to understand that wooden models were the standard at the time, and in Japan, plastic was new and unusual. With the release of this first plastic model, Yoshio's younger son, who was an art student, was tasked to create a new trademark. He created the star mark, and as many things in Japanese culture, everything about it had meaning. The red star stands for creativity and passion, and the blue star stands for youth and sincerity. At first, it was decorated with English, but with the release of its slot car series, the design was changed to its current form. From 1961, the box art corresponded to what they distributed. The artwork was mainly done by Shiguru Komatsuzaki and Yoshiyuki Takani. As Tamiya's image grew, their box art, which had a feeling of containing a story contained in a picture, eventually became mainstream. By example, here is some contemporary American artwork. As Tamiya migrated towards plastic models, they had their first real success in 1962 with a motorized kit of a German Panther tank. Despite the inaccuracy of its markings, this model tank is historically significant to model builders for another reason. Tamiya's wooden model tanks had been motorized and actually worked quite well, so they wanted to motorize this new tank, which meant it needed to have room for motors and batteries. When they were done, it just happened to be 1 to 35th scale, and Tamiya, being ultimately pragmatic, just said, "Okay, let's make all of our armor kits in this scale." This is how great decisions are made. Even to this day, the standard scale for armor models is 1 to 35, and that scale originated with this kit. In 1962, to become fully independent, the Tamiya Plastic Kogyo is formed, with Yoshio as the president. This is also when plastic injection molding machines are introduced. This was the beginning of Tamiya as a family business, which will be an important factor later on, as we will see. In 1964, Tamiya started their own metal molds division, which would make both their molds and molds for other companies, but more importantly, meant they were not dependent on outside contractors to make their molds. The next year, they began to develop high-performance slot cars. Starting in 1966, they transferred a number of craftsmen to the mold manufacturing facility. They slowly gained the know-how and came to make the molds that Tamiya is famous for today. As a result, they rapidly became known for the extremely high quality and accuracy of their kits, but also for charging a premium price for that accuracy. This is why other companies often misrepresented many of the details. A classic example was bolt and rivet heads. Most companies simply use small round protuberances to represent rivets, bolts, and nuts. But Tamiya actually went to the trouble of making hexagonal posts. This level of detail and thoroughness with which they produced their models earned them a reputation as one of the finest detailed kit model makers in the world. The excellent fit of the parts was another huge selling point. Many feel that Tamiya was and is in a class of its own. Tamiya also understood marketing promotion. In 1967, they started the Tamiya News, a monthly publication about the company's new products, model shops and clubs, and articles about expert modelers. In 1968, Tamiya got a lot of attention at the Nuremberg Toy Fair, particularly with their slot cars. Sales rose and the company needed to grow with them, but this change was not good for everybody. About this time, Tamiya had changed the box art to become more accurate, and to help with this, they simply put the subject matter against a white background. This was just an experiment, but it turned out to be popular. So, after that, Tamiya switched to the white box type packaging that we know today. Unfortunately for the artists, Komatsuzaki and Takani, whose artwork had contributed to the making of Tamiya's early image, much of their work eventually disappeared from Tamiya products. The company continued to prosper and expand, so in 1973, Tamiya moved into its newly constructed headquarters and factory. The next year, Yoshio was made president of Tamiya, a position he would hold for several years, but they were not idle years. In 1975, Tamiya released a radio-controlled M4 Sherman tank. This turned out to be the beginning of something very special. The next year, Tamiya released its radio-controlled model Porsche 934, which was simply their kit model Porsche 934 on a radio-controlled chassis, but it turned out to be extremely popular and many enthusiasts claim it launched the RC car boom. In fact, it was this year that Tamiya started receiving several of many Japanese cultural and business awards. The company kept growing, so they needed to move the headquarters to an even newer building, which they did in 1980. Yoshio was now in his late 70s, and it was time to pass on the leadership of the company. In 1984, his son, Shinsaku Tamiya, became chairman. This was about the time that Tamiya got themselves a mascot. Anybody recognize these two? This is Moko-chan with her rabbit sidekick, Rabi-kun. They were used as promotional and instructional anime characters in Japanese literature on how to make and maintain Tamiya products. They were discontinued in 1989, but they still have somewhat of a following with Tamiya and anime fans. In 1986, Tamiya released Tamtec, or Tamiya Technologies, RC models. This was an evolutionary step into other RC products for Tamiya, but they never really seemed to reach the popularity of the RC cars and tanks. Now, I'm also into RCs. I have both aircraft and tanks, and I have never seen a Tamiya RC aircraft at any of the flying fields I've been going to for years. The word in the community is that the Tamiya RCs were expensive, and in this case had no real edge over less expensive options. Their tanks, by comparison, are considered top of the line. But as usual, you pay Tamiya prices for it. In 1988, Tamiya issued the first quick drive series, which were 1 to 114 scale pre-built and simplified versions of Tamiya's 1 to 10 scale RC cars and trucks. This was designed to get kids interested in RC cars. This shows Tamiya's forward thinking about how to recruit the next generation of customers. It was also in 1988 that Yoshio Tamiya, the man who gave birth to the entire enterprise, died. He was 83. Tamiya would go on to develop a Grand Prix series of cars and a large motorcycle series. They also tried to kick off the new 1 to 100 scale with their mini jet series, but it never really caught on. That being said, they have been re-released as the combat jets. Tamiya has continued to be huge in kit models and has a long record as a leader in RC electric car racing. But in 1999, Tamiya was receiving requests from customers to update the racing platform. The result of this was the TRF414X series, a dedicated belt drive racing system. It morphed into the 414M and 414M2 series. These proved popular, and Tamiya has tried to stay in front of the huge RC car racing market. As a result, their technology has continued to evolve. After 2004, the aforementioned 1-to-100 scale model planes were re-released as the Combat Plane Series. This is in addition to their Warburg Collection, Motorcycle and Sports Car Series, Military Series, and the Genius Series, which are easy to construct robotic and powered kits. They even include robots. Their RC Tank Series is top shelf, but they can easily top $2,000, while other Tamiya tanks are only a few hundred. In fact, the pricing of Tamiya has often been confusing. An example of this is the 148 scale roof fighter plane, which sells for about $17, but the same scale P-51 Mustang is almost $33. I have both of these kits, and they are quite similar in quality, so I don't know what the price driver is, but there you go. Tamiya has always worked hard to maintain its quality control, but in 2017 they had a setback when Masayuki Tamiya, the president, died. He was only in his early 50s. But Shinsaku Tamiya is still the head of the company, and they have carried on despite the loss of the family heir apparent. That brings us up to today. So let's take a quick peek at Tamiya today. Although most of the Tamiya factories are in Japan, they do have one in the Philippines. They have four subsidiary companies: Tamiya America, Tamiya Philippines, Tamiya Hong Kong, and Tamiya Europe. Together they total about 1,200 employees worldwide. I wanted to go over their catalog, but it was just too big, so here's a very quick rundown. The 2020 catalog shows at over 80 kit model cars, 50 kit model airplanes, 250 kit model army and military miniatures, and 84 motorcycle kits, plus an entire Italeri series. In the radio control catalog, they had over 166 cars with several chassis options, 15 RC semi-trucks, and 31 RC tanks, 10 of them in the large 1-to-16 scale. This is in addition to crafts for kids, a first-class line of model building supplies, and even a solar car. I did not see any RC gliders or yachts. Tamiya is a hobby industry juggernaut. It's able to focus both on what it's doing and keep a strong eye on the future. I think a big part of its success is that it bears the family name, and in a culture where saving face is very important, nobody wants to put out anything less than the very best. I mean, let's get real. Tamiya has gone from wooden toys to robots. Tamiya is privately held and as such has different reporting standards, so I have no idea what the overall net value or sales of the company are. I do know that American Tamiya was listed as having between $10 and $50 million in annual sales, but that's a pretty wide gap. Tamiya does have a reputation for having a lot of employees and being a labor-intensive company. That's partly because Mr. Tamiya does not like to lose valuable employees, but also because they have a huge product line that requires a substantial, dedicated staff to properly guarantee quality control and sales support. Obviously, they place quality over quantity, but they're not shy about making you pay for it. Their sales appear strong, but that does not always equate directly into profits. Tamiya also faces some new challenges as companies like Blitz, that owns Revell Monogram, are starting to up their game. I'm currently doing a video on a head-to-head comparison using brand new 148 scale Tamiya and Revell P-51 Mustangs. The answer being sought in this video is a simple one. Is Tamiya worth paying almost twice as much for? We'll see when that video is done. But not to worry. Tamiya is going gangbusters, especially with the RCs, and I don't see anybody knocking them off the throne anytime soon. What say you? Tamiya's gone from wooden toys to freaking robots, people.
No.
No? Okay. My first Tamiya kit was a remote-controlled Model T-34 Russian tank. Not radio-controlled, remote-controlled. It actually had wires coming out of the back to a little hand controller unit. In the late 1960s, when I was playing with this thing, it was as whiz-bang as... It was positively whiz-bang. I can't remember the number of D-cell batteries I ran dry operating that thing. Tamiya is a hobbyist... Tamiya is a hobbyist... Jeez!